Which brings me to my next question. Professor, we know the story between Palestine and Israel. We know about the oppression. We know about the right to self-determination that was curtailed, the path to peace seemingly forever blocked. But when you look at what is happening in Israel, what justifies what Hamas is doing as we speak?
That's the big question, why Hamas did it at this time. And considering that Israel was going through some internal upheaval over some democracy issues, which could actually surface the question, the Palestine question, in the process, if it had given more leeway for, say, that kind of internal upheaval going on in Israel over things that they disagree with the Netanyahu government. But what we're seeing now is precisely the kind of hardlining of the stance and even some kind of unity being achieved behind all of this. So it's a big question that what Hamas did was in violation of international humanitarian law, targeting civilians, and it's the same for Israel now. They are also violating with this massive 138 airstrikes in a very small strip of land as of yesterday. Even the refugee camp was hit. And so there's this really gross violation of humanitarian law going on both sides.
A while ago, you said that you still cannot imagine the kind of impact this has on the geopolitical arena. Let's try to see what could possibly happen. What is in the realm of possibilities here? For sure, the world can't just sit idly and watch this as it happens.
Yes, that's true. We saw some normalization of relations between Israel and some of the Arab states in recent times. Of course, perhaps on the part of Palestine, this is not something that they wanted to see. We saw also, at the same time, really more extensive settlements being put set up by the Israeli government against the Palestinians in their communities. So it's really it's all of this question now, and now we fear that Iran might be dragged into this equation. I was listening to some of the news coming out from some stations the other day, and it's one, you know, is if you drag in the question of Iran and the United States, which is probably not avoidable, but if you put in that into the equation, then you have a really, really much bigger problem at hand.
Talk to us about that problem. What can we expect if that problem becomes a reality,
all of these issues, and not just the Palestinian question, or not just about how can two peoples coexist and what sort of governance can be put in place, but then it goes into precisely all of these bigger questions about the Shiites as against all of this fractiousness that also divides the Middle East and the world in itself. And we don't want that. We want to keep this focus because it does beg some form of resolution, although very, very hard. We want to keep that focus on this question. But otherwise, it will get murkier and murkier with different state national interests at stake. Mm-hmm. And we don't really know how it will end up in terms of the political alignments.
At this point, who's the likely mediator?
The U.S. could have played that role precisely, but then it decided to jump into on one side immediately. Maybe it feared that this is another 9/11 in the making. So, without, you know, perhaps if it had given itself two more days to think about the situation, then it could precisely play that kind of mediation role, considering its influence on Israel and the fact that it's an accepted power all around. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, we would expect other countries who have been doing this work, perhaps, some other Arab countries, maybe Turkey and so on. I don't know about the European states. They've also, some of them have immediately withdrawn their support for some of their projects in for Palestinians. And that's why part of the discourse really now is this now going to be a collective punishment on all the people, on all Palestinians, whether in fact they actually supported what Hamas did or they're actually not even, they don't even like Hamas because of the very bad governance that it has shown over the years ruling the Gaza Strip. But what, so I think from the humanitarian point of view, the international community, of course the UN is still there, should really try to broker something.
Let me just go back to what you said a while ago. The U.S. could have played that role of mediator, but they promised too much too soon. Would you call that a miscalculation or a wrong move by the U.S.?
I think there's the local constituency that they had to respond to, and of course the acts committed against the you know innocent civilians, Israeli civilians, was really horrible. So maybe there was that kind of spontaneous response. But even listening now to some of the commentators, even some of the military strategies, American military strategies, we're seeing the dangers of the U.S. getting too involved. It brings back to mind what happened in Iraq, what happened in, you know, even in Afghanistan, putting your troops there as well, or even just your presence there, and then committing. And so on. They realize the complication of doing, for example, ground war inside the Gaza Strip, which is, and the same goes for the Israeli military, which probably is positioning now after the airstrikes to really go in and like mow the grass or whatever, you know, really scorch earth approach coming in. But it's also precisely putting them at risk, because this is territory of these communities.
It's very difficult to watch history repeat itself. It's like you're predicting the next move and it's actually happening and you don't want it to happen, but it keeps on playing. It's like a movie that never ends. How do you get off this vicious cycle of war? I mean, already you hear of Israel preparing to launch a massive retaliation. I mean, the siege of Gaza, that's not even part of it. So how do you break that cycle of war? How do you even get out of it? Is Israel and Palestine, are they both, you know, beyond that point of getting out of this cycle?
Somehow, I think they were the actions were trying to break the cycle and find some kind of, you know, resolution, because the status quo for the Palestinians, for example, has become very, very difficult considering the kinds of oppression and the fact that, you know, in the presence of occupied forces, the limited movements, the very poor conditions that they are in. So in one sense, they might want to break the status quo and come up with some kind of a resolution. Mm. But although, of course, it was a very big risk. And now we hear Israel saying that this is not going to be a repeat precisely of that cycle, that they're going to change the situation on the ground so that it doesn't become precisely the way it was before, where no resolution was in place. But at what cost, precisely? I think that's the big question. At what cost to human lives, and what kind of protracted warfare are we going to see in the years to come before an actual resolution actually happens?
And finally, Professor, I want to talk to you about the propaganda. I mean, in the early wars that we saw, absent the internet, absent social media, that was bad enough, right? But now that you have that other added layer of these so-called videos, we don't know if it's been verified or not, the information that's coming in and out of Israel, and people really just pouncing on it as well, taking it as the truth without even verifying it. Talk to us about the danger of that and what it adds to the situation.
Definitely, misinformation, especially through social media, aggravates the problem. It creates precisely that kind of polarization that we're seeing now. Not only those who are directly in the battlefield, but also or in the crossfire of the battlefields. But precisely the rest of the international community. So we see hardening of stances, greater polarization, instead precisely creating bridges to be able to talk through first this current state of war, and then eventually talk through a solution that can provide some of the compromises that are necessary for coexistence.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. We've run out of time. Professor Miriam Coronel Ferrer, their co-founder of Southeast Asia Women Peace Mediators, and of course 2023 Ramon Magsaysay awardee. Thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate the conversation we just had.
Thank you.
Maraming salamat po.